Good afternoon. On Saturday, the President's Council of Economic Advisors released a new report on the impact of health care reform on small businesses and their employees. In his weekly address, the President asked for your feedback on the subject, and the feedback was overwhelming. We got hundreds of questions on whitehouse.gov and more than 1,500 questions from among the millions of small business professionals who are part of the LinkedIn network. Thanks to everyone who gave us your questions and comments. We left it up to LinkedIn to pick the questions that they thought were most representative and insightful of the larger group. They had several of their small business members comb through the list and choose about 9 or 10. We're going to go through those questions, but also keep an eye on the chat happening now through Facebook. And of course, we'll be looking for your feedback and questions as well. We should note for transparency's sake that since we wanted to make sure that we answered your questions as best as possible, we looked over the questions in advance to make sure we could give you the information that you were looking for. It was a tough call between the element of surprise and giving you really the most thoughtful answers possible. But without further ado, we're going to welcome CEA Chair Christina Romer with the first question.
Great. Let me start by reminding you that what we are going to be talking about is a new report that the Council of Economic Advisors did put out on Saturday about the economic effects of healthcare reform on small businesses and their employees. And I highly recommend that people go to whitehouse.gov or to the Council of Economic Advisors website and read the whole report. I thought what I'd do to begin with is to talk a little bit about the report. Actually, before I do that, I do want to thank all of the people that sent in responses. It was truly overwhelming. We had asked the question about tell us about your experiences, and I have to say we have learned a tremendous amount from hearing from so many small business owners about the problems that they face. And one of the really interesting things is how much it correlates with exactly what we were identifying in our report. Because one of the things that our report talks about is just the burdens that the current healthcare system places on small businesses. And I'll give you one statistic. A small business pays about 18% more for comparable coverage than a big firm, right? So that automatically puts them at a big disadvantage. Either they have to pay lower take-home wages to their workers, and then they have a harder time competing for the best workers, or that extra cost that they incur comes out of their profits, and then they have less to invest and grow their businesses. So it definitely is a problem. One of the places that this shows up is a lot of small business owners are finding it difficult to offer insurance to their employees. And again, to give you a number, for firms that are 3 to 9 employees, I think it's just 49% of them offer insurance to their workers, where when you get to a firm with 200 employees, basically 99% of them offer coverage, right? So that is a big difference. It's showing up in where do we see people going without insurance? It's often people that work in small firms. And so absolutely the current system is not working well for small businesses. And so exactly what our report looked at is how are the reform proposals that are being considered in Congress in consultation with the administration designed to help small businesses to deal with some of these burdens that they face. And there are lots of ways. One is that the proposals all call for the creation of an insurance exchange, a place where individuals and small businesses can go to buy insurance, a place where there'll be no exclusions on pre-existing conditions, where we'll spread the administrative costs over many more people so that the prices for good, high-quality insurance are much more like what you'd get if you were a large business owner. So that's certainly going to be an important way that it will ease the burden for small businesses. Another thing that the proposals all have in common is some kind of a tax credit for small businesses that do provide insurance for their employees. That's a way to, again, ease the burden on them, help their bottom line, make sure they can still grow their businesses, create jobs. And we absolutely think that's important. Another benefit has to do with what we call the pay or play requirements. You know, those are requirements being put into a lot of the plans being discussed to encourage medium and large businesses to keep providing insurance. And one of the things that the bills are being careful to do is to exempt small businesses. For example, one of the bills coming out of the Senate says that these requirements won't apply to firms with fewer than 25 employees. And again, we think that's important. We don't want to put extra burdens on small firms. We want to make them more able to do what we hear, and I certainly saw in so many of your responses, what you want to do, which is to provide health insurance for your employees. Another important fact about the plans working their way through Congress is that for a small business owner that doesn't provide insurance, the exchange is going to be a place where the workers can still go to get coverage, right? Where they won't have to pay those high rates that they face in the individual market, where they won't face exclusions for pre-existing conditions, where if you're a low-income worker, you'll get a subsidy from the government to help you be able to buy insurance. And we think that that's why we talk about this is a win not just for small business owners, but absolutely for their employees. The last thing I'd mention in terms of the things in the bills designed to help or to encourage small businesses has to do with labor mobility. Right? One of the things we know now is that some workers are afraid to leave jobs or to start their own business because they're afraid of losing their health insurance. They're afraid of not being able to get health insurance because of a pre-existing condition. And so one of the benefits that we can anticipate if we get a better working system with a place where everybody can be sure they can go and buy low-cost, high-quality insurance, that people will unleash really a really entrepreneurial talent, people willing and able to strike it out, start a new business, a small business that is so important for job creation, and we think that's going to be a big benefit. The only other thing I'd mention, again, I'd love for you to go to the CEA website because we did a report back in June about more generally about how healthcare reform is important for the entire economy. And I think we don't want to lose sight of that, that though we're talking about small businesses today, you know, we're all part of this country and we're all going to benefit from the health reform proposals that we've been talked about that will expand coverage and will absolutely slow the growth rate of healthcare costs. And that is so important for the economy, that by slowing the growth rate of costs, we anticipate that that's going to have a big impact on standards of living, again, for everybody, not just for small businesses and their employees. We also expect it to have some benefits on the budget deficit, right? We know that going forward, the biggest fiscal challenge we're going to face is the fact that government-provided healthcare in the form of Medicare and Medicaid, those costs are going up along with all the health costs in the economy, and that's going to put a real strain on the federal budget deficit. The kind of reforms that we're talking about, designed to slow the growth rate of costs, will have a big impact on the budget deficit going out 20, 30 years, and that's just crucially important. Lastly, I would focus in on jobs, because one of the benefits of slowing the growth rate of costs is we do think you can go through a period of time where unemployment can be lower, where employment growth can be higher without generating inflation. And so that's something that we can look forward to as we return to full employment. And if we can then get our healthcare costs growing more slowly, we can absolutely look for a period of improved labor market performance. So all of those, again, are things that every American citizen will benefit from, and small business owners and their employees are part of that family. All right, well, with that, let's turn it over to questions.
Great, that was a fantastic overview. Our first question is coming from Abraham Jenkins, president and CEO at Launchpad Careers in Los Angeles. And he asks, how will the current healthcare proposals level the playing field so small businesses can effectively compete with large corporations for human capital?
It's a great question. It's exactly what I was just talking about. Remember how I said that small businesses today provide or pay about 18% more for the same coverage, right? That absolutely hurts them in the labor market, right? If the normal way that shows up is they pay less in the form of take-home wages to their employees. Well, that makes it harder for them to compete with a big firm to hire the best workers. Or we see, you know, one of the other phenomena that we see is typically in small businesses, the health insurance plans are less generous. Well, that again is less of a lure. If I have a choice between a big firm and a small firm, I may well go with the big firm with the more generous health insurance package. So any of the changes that we've been talking about, the exchange where small businesses can go and buy really high quality plans that fit their workers' needs at a much more reasonable price, because they do get the benefits of risk pooling of the lower administrative costs. That's going to help them in finding and attracting the best workers. Yeah, let me just give you one interesting fact. You know how I talked about the phenomenon of sometimes you don't get, people may be afraid to join small businesses because of the less good health insurance, or the fear that, you know, they have a pre-existing condition and so they won't get covered. One fact that we discovered is there are a lot more people over 65 who are working in small businesses. Well, what happens when you turn 65? You qualify for Medicare. And so one of the things that we think that shows is there are a lot of people that would love to start their own business, but one thing, they're being held back for fear of will they have health insurance coverage. If we can put in place the reforms we've been talking about, so everybody can be sure they will qualify, they'll be able to get a high quality, reasonably priced plan, we do think it will really increase entrepreneurial talent and help us to create more small businesses, which I didn't even talk about that, but in our report we do talk about how small businesses really are engines of job creation. They really are a source of innovation. Those aren't just buzz phrases, that's the truth. And so anything we can do to help this crucial sector of the economy prosper and grow is good for the whole economy.
Thank you, Christy. The next question comes from whitehouse.gov. According to the CEA report, the government plan offers exemptions to many of the smallest companies that collectively employ a large number of our workers. What prevents these small businesses from simply not offering coverage or outsourcing their work to other countries at a lower cost?
All right, so there are a couple of things. One is, it is true that the plans in front of Congress do exempt small businesses, and that is, you know, very much aimed. We talked about the burdens that are already on small businesses in the current healthcare system. We don't want to do something that will burden them further, and so that absolutely is why, for example, the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions draft of the bill exempts firms with fewer than 25 employees, and so that is very much designed to make it easier for them to deal with the current situation. The other thing, of course, is that we are proposing tax credits to help, and certainly the bills include tax credits to help small firms pay for health insurance for their workers. And so that's something that will be a benefit. You know, one of the things that I've been really struck, I've done a lot of work and talking with Karen Mills, who's the administrator of the Small Business Administration. And one of the points that she makes is that, you know, workers in small businesses, well, often are family, but often, if not family, feel like family. And so, you know, what we hear and what I saw in so many of your responses is small business owners want to provide health insurance for their workers. They're being dissuaded, or it's made very hard for them by the fact that it's so expensive. And so one of the things that we're exactly trying to do is create institutions like the Insurance Exchange where we can bring down the prices much more to the level of bigger businesses so that they can do what they want to do for their businesses. In terms of the outsourcing, I mean, I think the crucial thing is most small business owners, right, they want to create their business. They want to grow their business here. And so we absolutely think that they will keep doing that. Another thing that we certainly discovered in our study, right, small businesses are throughout the economy. They are everything from manufacturing to construction, but there are also a lot of them in the service sector. And things like construction and service sector jobs like food service and professional services, those are things that really can't be outsourced. And so it's another way in which the small business sector is so important to the economy and helping us to grow and stay a healthy economy.
Great point. Okay, we have a question from another LinkedIn member, AJ Vasquez from Miami, emailing in from his law firm. He has a question on affordability and availability. A small business owner should have a competitive selection of comparable health plans to choose from. As a small business, taking care of my people is important to me. Creating an environment that focuses on wellness is also a priority in my law firm. Healthy, productive employees are not only great for the company, but ultimately great for their families and their communities. It's a win-win situation, and it's well worth the effort. How will you or the proposed healthcare plans improve competition in healthcare to allow for more competitive healthcare plans? And what will this plan do to promote a more healthy environment through wellness? A lot of questions.
Yeah, I know. I may have to look over to make sure I get all of them. You know, the big point of the question, which is, you know, so much in the president's mind, is, you know, one of the number one benefit of expanding, why do we talk about expanding coverage? It's because we think when people get health insurance coverage, they're healthier and that they have access to primary care. They do have, and primary care physicians tend to put more emphasis on preventative care rather than just treating a problem after it develops. So that is a big part of why, you know, the president has always had these two goals, expanding coverage to improve health and putting in reforms that are going to slow the growth rate of costs to ensure the health of the overall economy. And those are our two crucial goals. You know, on this issue of health, I mean, one of the things that's important is it's particularly the health of workers is particularly important, you know, well, obviously for everyone, right? So it's a win if we can have healthier people, they're better workers, they're more productive, they're less absenteeism. But it's particularly important for small businesses, because those of you that have small businesses know you don't have, you know, lots of other people when someone's absent who can fill in the slack. And so we think that the changes that lower absenteeism and increase productivity by making people healthier are particularly important for small businesses. Now, about the affordability, right? We've talked about how the exchange is one way to help make health insurance more affordable by spreading administrative costs and pooling risk. The president's also talked about the importance of competition, right? So he said that, you know, he thinks a public option, a public plan in the exchange is going to be a useful thing, right? He absolutely says any public plan has to stand on its own two feet. It can't be subsidized by the government. It needs to be playing on a level playing field with the other insurance providers. But he does think for some markets, especially where you might only have one or two insurance companies that want to provide coverage in that market, making sure that there's always competition, that there's another provider, the public plan, can be useful in keeping costs down and providing leadership. You know, one of the things I've been surprised is when we talk to private insurance companies, they talk about the role that Medicare and the public plan can play in kind of being innovators and leading the way of in, you know, more creative forms of payment systems. How do you give doctors the incentives to really provide the best possible care without the waste and inefficiency that we know are there in our system today? And so we do think that the government has a very positive role that it can play and will ultimately show up in a slower growth rate of costs. The last one, I don't want to let go because I love the point about prevention. I mean, that is something the president, the first lady have talked about so much that one of the great benefits of a system, you know, one of the things in our health reform system, the proposals call for making sure that preventative care is, you know, that we encourage that both by making sure people have coverage, but also in sort of what the co-pays and things can be for preventative care, because we do think that's important, obviously, for health, but also for ultimately reining in costs. Things like weight management, smoking cessation programs, those things absolutely pay for themselves, and that's an important point, and good for business, good for the economy, and good for people.
All right. So we have another question from a LinkedIn member, a Mark Young, who's the president of Zantec, which is a watch repair company in Peoria, Illinois. He asks, insurance was never intended to be a perk, but rather to be a necessary component of running a business, provided to compete for better employees. How did we move from healthcare being a benefit to a requirement that businesses provide insurance?
All right, so first let's talk about the, you know, I think one of the good points that he makes is this idea, it comes back to the level playing field in hiring workers, right? That we do know that it is something that workers care about. And one of the reasons they might not go to a small firm is because they don't provide health insurance. And so we do think that it is something that makes small, that current system where so many small business owners find it hard to provide insurance because it is disproportionately expensive for them, it does disadvantage them in the hiring of labor. So I think that one we absolutely would agree on. In terms of requirements, again, we want to be a little bit careful here. Absolutely, what we've been talking about is in the health reform proposals that are working their way through Congress, any of the employer responsibility or the pay or play requirements, they're carving out exemptions for small businesses. And just to give you a number, right? So I think one of the Senate versions of the bill exempts small firms with fewer than 25 employees. Well, that's about 91% of all firms in the economy. And if you think about most of the firms in the other 9% are already providing insurance, it really, we're being very careful to make sure that we're not putting additional burdens on small firms. Now, why do you have these at all? And why might you want to have some employer responsibility requirements? It does come down to disruption, right? That sort of starting after World War II, one of the things that we did is to really give special tax treatment to employer-sponsored health insurance. And that's really kind of made that the normal way that most people get their health insurance. And so that is the system that we're most used to. It's kind of what the president's described the American way in terms of health care insurance and provision. And I think one of the things that the president's been very worried about or wanted to make sure we prevented is any big disruption, right? One of the things he said from the beginning, if you like what you have, you can keep it, because we know that a lot of Americans do like what they have, and we don't want to disrupt a system that's working well for a lot of people. We want to take what we have and improve it and fix anything that's broken. And so that's been the motivation for why we have certainly a lot of the bills have some of these requirements. We want to make sure that we don't change the incentives too much and have some of the big companies that have been providing insurance for years, we don't want them changing their behavior. And that's really what those are aimed at, not putting new requirements on small businesses.
All right, we have a question from Daniel Rosberg from Kansas City, Missouri. He's the president of DataWorks, and he asks, is making a small business responsible for providing health care simply giving a competitive advantage to big business? Why not just start with tort reform and mandating insurers to cover pre-existing conditions and make all policies fully portable regardless of state, company, or position?
All right, so again, let me emphasize, right, exactly what we're not doing is putting requirements on small businesses. And if anything, where there are these employer responsibility requirements, they're going on the medium and large firms that today, the vast majority of them are already providing insurance. And so that is absolutely what we're designing to do, not increase any of the burdens on small firms. We're trying to get rid of the burdens that are there. And I can't emphasize that enough. You know, the people that talk about not wanting to change things, well, what they're really doing is condemning small businesses to a system that isn't working well for them and their employees, right? They're condemning small businesses to paying the higher costs that they're paying now. They're condemning many workers in small firms to not have insurance because of those high costs. And so very much what we're talking about is easing the burdens on small firms. I think it is good to, the president and Congress have been talking about lots of proposals for slowing the growth rate of costs. One we do hear is the importance of tort reform or having to do with lowering some of the problems with malpractice and the possibility that there's defensive medicine. A couple of things to say about that. One is certainly the experts that we have talked to say that, defensive medicine is a phenomenon that's there, but probably is not adding very much to cost. So that in terms of what are the big drivers, why are health care costs and therefore insurance costs rising over time? Well, there are lots having to do with the incentives that we give to doctors in terms of valuing volume over value. And certainly we think that there's a lot of things, you know, technological change has been a big driver in the growth rate of healthcare costs. So we don't think that defensive medicine is one of the really big drivers. But that said, the president, when he spoke to the American Medical Association, did talk about some common sense reforms. You know, one of the things that we've talked about with Congress, the importance of getting information. So you may have heard comparative effectiveness research, just trying to find out what works and what doesn't, what procedures really do improve outcomes for patients. Well, one of the things that kind of fits into that the president's talked about is, you know, one of the things we could do to help give doctors a sense of what's a reasonable standard of care, have doctors get together, set guidelines, things like that about what are reasonable protocols, reasonable standards, that's maybe an in-between way of certainly giving doctors some more protection so they know what's a sensible thing that is likely to be required of them, but not go too far in terms of say capping payments in malpractice cases, something that the president hasn't supported. So we do think there's some good common sense things that could be done and could be beneficial. I want to also, one of the points had to be about, well, shouldn't we get limitations on pre-existing conditions? Absolutely. I think there's nothing we agree with more. And the president has said, you know, when we set up this insurance exchange where small businesses and individuals can go to get care, one of the things that he said is there can't be an exclusion on pre-existing conditions. People need to have the security that if they ever lose their employer-sponsored care, there is a place they can go and be sure that they can buy health insurance at a reasonable price, right? So that, I think, is very important. And then again, on the portability, part of what goes into, again, knowing that you have that option through the exchange, it does free you up. You don't have to say, gee, I'm afraid of leaving this job even though I see this other one that's really good, but what if I can't qualify for insurance at that new firm, or what if they don't offer insurance? By making sure that we have a high quality, reasonable priced option for people, does give them that kind of portability. And we do think, one of the things we talked about in our earlier study, we do think it will improve the efficiency of the labor market. And that's good for people and good for economic growth.
All right, well, although we still have many, many questions left from the LinkedIn community, we're gonna turn to Facebook and take one of the many questions coming in live from Facebook before we have to wrap up. There have been a lot of questions, or there seems to be maybe some misunderstanding between what's being proposed on the Hill and by the president and a single payer system. Can you differentiate a little bit of maybe why we're not looking at the single payer system and why the president's emphasizing what he is emphasizing in his healthcare proposal?
Sure. So when people talk about single payer, what they have in mind is what we see in some other countries like Canada, the United Kingdom, where the government provides health insurance for everybody, right? And that would be, and that is a model. As the president said, it's not the American way, right? That we are used to private insurance, and it does, that system has worked well for many Americans. And so, you know, he thinks that for preserving what's good and going from there, that it makes sense to stay with what we have. Right? And so that's why he's proposed sort of building on the system that we have and how to make it work better, make sure that everybody can get coverage, make sure that coverage is more affordable, make sure that we do the innovations and the reforms that will slow the growth rate of costs. Right? All of that we do think is absolutely important. The one thing that the president has said when he's talked about having a public plan, his vision of this is, right, when we have this insurance exchange where you can go if you're a small business or if you're an individual, right, and you don't have coverage from your employer. You know, one of the things he said is among your range of options, you'll have private firms, you'll have nonprofit, a lot of insurance in this country is already done by nonprofits. he said, it makes sense to make sure you have another option, which is a public plan, where the government, again, on a level playing field with everybody else, but just another option as a way of making sure that Americans do have choice, making sure that there's always competition in this exchange. And so we do think that that's important.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Christy. That was a great chat, and we appreciate you taking your time today.
All right. Thank you so much.